Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE's coverage here in Las Vegas. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE with Paul Nashawaty, who's here, CUBE analyst, covering the app dev category for theCUBE research. Paul, great to see you. Thanks for coming on theCUBE here at reInvent. I know you've been buzzing in the hallways. Man, you had so many meetings. I saw you sitting down with some big time players here at AWS. Great to see you digging in, and they're digging into you because obviously what you're covering right now is in their wheelhouse. I talked to Deepak Singh, one of his VPs I know you just met with. You're in the hallways. I saw you having multiple conversations with folks. This is a target-rich environment for you. This is app dev, the Super Bowl of app dev is one of the, this is one of the major sporting events for the app dev world.
Sure.
That you're covering. This is what's, how are you feeling?
Oh, no, I feel great, John. Thanks for having me on. This is an amazing event. I mean, it really is. I think it's a win for customers and prospects that are trying to modernize and trying to figure out what they're looking to do with their initiatives, right? And one of the things I've been, you know, covering Amazon for years, right? And like one of the things I've been noticing is the growth of building these platforms and having these tech stacks to kind of help with these modernization efforts. The buzz on the hallway, and it is consistent over the last couple of years, is reduce complexity, reduce that skill gap issue, reduce the challenges that organizations run into. And Amazon is delivering. They're delivering. They're putting together these unified packages that don't offer this bag of bits anymore. Mm-hmm. And they're offering like a single way of kind of delivering how to deliver this tech stack so it makes these initiatives easier.
This year in the hallway conversation, what specifically have you heard? What jumps out at you? Yeah. Obviously the announcements, we saw the P6 instance with NVIDIA, the GA of Trainium2 Ultra clusters with their Neuralink, and then yeah, they're saying they have more compute than any cloud, so clearly doing the homework and doing their job at the infrastructure layer, new more S3 table buckets, mm-hmm. Metadata, so DSQL, I mean, you're starting to see then model distillation and Bedrock. I mean, a slew of announcements. It makes Microsoft Ignite look like a picnic, right? I mean, they had Copilot upgrades and Amazon's just dropping, then Andy Jassy comes on stage and drops the mega bomb, which is the Nova suite of their models. So Amazon's kind of delivering. So, and then obviously with the inference, the story I did with Matt Garman, he said inference will change how software's written. And if you hear what they're saying, they're basically saying, we're going back to basics. We're going to take care of the infrastructure, make it super great and enabling, but we care about the developer building stuff.
Yeah.
And that is the developer. That is the app dev category. Your category is core to their strategy because they're going to create the middleware, my word, not theirs, but the middle of the stack to bridge the high performance infrastructure with the agility and the ease of use for the developer. This is what the cloud native world at, like in Kubernetes, you know, Dave Brown even said to me, yeah, Kubernetes is boring, which is we want it to be like Linux.
Yeah.
So it's all coming together.
Absolutely.
What's your reaction to that?
John, you couldn't be any more correct on this. It's not just all coming together. It's the narrative of the app dev world, which is the past, present, future, and bridging the gap between all of it, right? And basically taking the ability of, you know, all the texts that you just mentioned, you know, whether looking at Apache Iceberg support or integration of analytics across the environment, but it is that bridging the old with the new, right? And having that seamless integration of your existing data sets, the data lakes that exist, and have that working with the new systems of record or system engagements that you're building is really an important a path forward. But what we're finding is in our research, we see that 67% of organizations are hiring generalists over specialists, which is they're pushing back to organizations like Amazon to say reduce complexity so we can have a generalist do this work. And that's what they're delivering on, is having a generalist do the work, abstracting the layer, making it simpler for the platform engineering teams to deliver and produce results. We also see in the same study that over 800 person respondent study that we see that there's 24% of organizations want to release code on an hourly basis, yet only 8% can do so. And that's because they're dealt with all these challenges and this complexity and skill gap issues. So Amazon is coming together with everything you just mentioned, we could speak for hours on, right?
But, I want to get your thoughts on something that I've been observing. I haven't really talked publicly about it, but I want to riff with you on it.
Yes.
I remember back when we started theCUBE 15 years ago, OpenStack was the rage. Okay, OpenStack was pre what I call mainstream cloud.
Yeah.
So Amazon, I think, kicked into gear when reInvent was 2012, their first ever. But let's just pick 2013, the year theCUBE started covering reInvent. So between 2013 to say 2020, the pandemic, it was just massive growth. They ran the table. They ran away from the field. Before that, Amazon was criticized as a specialty thing. Some call it the junkyard of piece your own pieces together, because at that time it was mostly in favor with startups who were resource constrained and didn't want to buy servers. And the classic story, swipe the credit card. OpenStack was the promise.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, OpenStack's going to save the world, and OpenStack ended up becoming a telco thing. But there was so much infighting and storage protocols. There was a lot of it was open source. It was cool. We loved it, OpenStack. But and then Amazon just actually did everything. Okay, yeah. So that's great. Now, why am I bringing this up? With the CNCF and KubeCon,
yeah,
we've seen the platform engineering community. Mm-hmm. A lot of that DNA is a little bit OpenStack and cloud, so it's cloud native. Open source contributors from the Lyfts of the world and Netflix. You're seeing all these great open source projects. So I think the CNCF has done amazing work to essentially start building the community for cloud native. It's now very commercial, and that's rolling right into cloud. So the question is, does cloud native, I won't say capitulate, but like, do they actually recognize that maybe Amazon and the hyperscales might run away with it? And will they become OpenStack? And so my riff is, okay, I personally don't see it that way, but I'm seeing the same kind of signs. Dogmatic arguments about this, that, and the other thing. No, what's the bottom line? Let's scale up the infrastructure.
Sure.
So that's, if you look at Amazon's announcement, you can go to Cloud Native and say, hey, get your act together, guys and gals. Get stable. Kubernetes is doing its job.
Yeah.
Cloud Native has to pace up, level up. What's your reaction to that? And I know you cover this deeply. Am I off base? Am I all wet on this one? Or am I other similarities?
No, I mean, John, I think you're spot on. I think that there's, when we looked at the evolution of Amazon and the hyperscalers in general, there was if you remember, everybody was saying, oh, everything's going to the cloud. Everything will be in the cloud. And that's not the case, right? And what we actually find in our research and what we're seeing, and I'm seeing more and more at these events that we go to, and Amazon is definitely showing it here, is 94% of organizations use two or more clouds. 65% use four or more clouds, right? And if they're using these multi-cloud or distributed cloud environments, that means that there needs to be a way to kind of use that tech stack across these different cloud environments. So the CNCF and the projects that are being put in place, all that's doing is amplifying that ability to use that scale-up architecture, but making the cloud underneath it invisible. Right, and basically, if you make things cloud native, we also see that portability. 20% of respondents indicated that it's critical for their applications to be portable. So having that multi-cloud.
So you think CNCF is aligned with the kind of this current velocity trend?
I do. That's, I think, great. There's alignment there. I think it's becoming more abstracted. The cloud, as long as you're building the applications that are rapid. And this is also businesses are trying to, as I mentioned, they want to release code on an hourly basis, right? 8%. Are doing it. And now the business case.
8% are doing, people want to release software on an hourly basis, but only 8% can do it.
That's right.
Okay, so that means there's a huge gap.
Yeah, in that same survey, 24% said that they want to, right? And 8% can do it. And so it's because the complexity of the underlying architecture really is preventing.
So what are you seeing as challenges to overcome that? Are there blockers? Is it just inertia? What are some of the challenges that are preventing them, and what can they do?
Well, I mean, take SageMaker, for example. The announcement Amazon SageMaker came out, right? SageMaker allowed for these four individual pillars that were four different parts of the tech stack that previously, in previous years, were all available, right? But that tech stack that was available before was kind of cobble together your own bits to make it all work. And what SageMaker did was made it easier for deployments, right? And that's what's going on. And that's the kind of the enabler for allowing for that invisible cloud architecture and allowing for that portability across these different environments.
Got it. I know you've done a lot of analysis on cloud native and app dev because it kind of intersects. Reinvent so far, your takeaway from the show here, keynotes, conversations, how would you boil up the summary if you had to kind of summarize kind of what the vibe is,
yeah,
what the focus is, what it means to customers?
Yeah, this is the conversation I've had with the Amazon execs as well. Is I feel that there's very much a developer-centric view here, the practitioner view here. Yeah. I think that they're missing a lot of that kind of business value messaging. They really need to kind of up-level some of these. I know they have tracks for business value and such, but that they have to up-level that conversation and say why this matters. Because when I sit with CIOs and I talk to CIOs around like what they're running and they say monetization is our challenge, but yet they're not aware of some of the tech that's available here. That's a big takeaway. I think Amazon can kind of really help drive that message forward instead of being so focused on the developer. But with that said, the developer is my passion. Yeah. So I don't want to give that up.
I mean, they're not mutually exclusive. I mean, people stand in line because the sessions are damn good on developers and the platform folks because they're enabling everything. But we just heard from Lori Beer, who's the CIO of JPMorgan Chase. Her narrative is all about modernization, to your point. Right. So you got to thread the needle on that piece.
Yeah.
And it's almost tough for Amazon because, again, they're running so fast. The pace of play, again, like to compare Microsoft's event that they just had compared to reInvent, it's just like, I mean, it's almost night and day in between the tsunami of announcements that are more meaty on AWS. I mean, Microsoft had, you know, some kind of co-pilot messaging upgrades, like, okay, but they didn't really have a lot of meat on the bone that I saw there compared to here. I mean, they dropped mega announcements here at reInvent. So I just see more progress on scale, reliability. Again, I think Amazon is not listening to the skeptics. I think they're going back to their roots where there's always play to your strengths, right?
Yeah.
And I wrote a quote on one of the things, is a famous quote from a University of Texas coach that said, dance with the ones who brung you. It really inspires, it's about loyalty and to the players and the team. And what you're seeing Amazon doing is saying, they're going back to their roots, not only for their core competency that they're bread and butter, but their customers. You're seeing the Garmin saying developer, he led with community heroes.
Community, yeah.
He led the keynote with community.
Yeah.
He led the keynote with, I love developers.
Right.
If that's not a tell.
Yeah. Yeah, and not only that, but the third-party integration, the ecosystem is there, and that's what makes it. I think you're right. Amazon is going to customer choice, right? They're going back to the customer, and if the customer chooses to go whichever direction, like we were talking about, they're across these multi-hyperscalers, and there's a lot of going on there. There needs to be a way to work in it, and I think the days of old of saying you're going to come to our cloud, you're going to use our tech stack, those days are gone.
Yeah, and to your point, complexity, I think, is huge, because we had Emma on. They're a startup. Emma does multi-cloud unification. I'm oversimplifying it, but they manage the complexity between the multiple environments. And multi-cloud just means, you know, multiple clouds. Also, different environments like edge and on-prem, obviously. Having that unification, because you have different tech stacks in different environments, that's got to change.
It does. And again, harmonization across that. I mean, we find in our, again, I'm an analyst, I go to research. That's what I know, right?
What's the research tell you?
Well, our research shows that, latest study shows that 75% of respondents in this 800 plus person research survey indicated that they're using 6 to 15 different tools to collect observability data. And that's just on observability data. Mm-hmm. Never mind the platform. So those actionable insights on day two, feeding it back into the CI/CD pipeline, it makes it super complex when you have all these different tools.
Yeah, and your point about the business messaging and the CIO that you talk, the CIO you talk to, and the tech tracks they have here have to intersect, because what Lori Beer said here on theCUBE, JPMorgan Chase, their critical infrastructure, she said, and their scale, and she wants to help people learn more, so she's sharing, and she said they had. I asked the resilience question, which is a trick question because there's no answer for it, and she was the first one actually gave an answer,
right?
Because they're so disciplined. Given their business model, they have a resilience framework, okay? Now, that's not being talked about here. So if you're gonna let builders run wild, which Amazon's strategy clearly is, go build.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. I mean, they're pushing to this.
They got a lot of building going on. It's like, and you rein it in. It's like Andy Grove said, let chaos reign, rein in the chaos. Okay, if I'm gonna let people build, I have to have some standards around things like benchmark qualifications, risk management, resilience. This is like business.
Yeah. Well, all right. I mean, compliance and regulations are key, right? Especially when you start getting into global instantiations of applications in GDPR and data sovereignty issues. That's a big challenge for a lot of applications.
Yeah. Well, I think this has been one of the best reInvents, at least for me personally. I had five interviews on the front end. We had Dave Brown, who now runs compute. He was an OG.
Yep.
He worked on EC2 in South Africa with the core team there. Obviously, Matt Garmin ran EC2.
And right.
Yeah, I don't know if you heard Matt Garmin's comment on stage. Like, I have a lot of products. I don't want to pick any favorites, but I love EC2. He picked the favorite right there, kind of tongue-in-cheek. He's got that dry humor. But what he's saying is it's a core building block.
It is, yeah.
Dave Brown was talking about the Trainium and the Ultra servers. You know, don't count out Amazon on the infrastructure as a service.
Right.
I'm expecting them to dominate.
Yeah. And there's also, of course, I can't believe we went this far in the conversation and never didn't mention AI, because like AI has to be mentioned in every conversation, but GPU utilization and processor utilization, that is something that I'm seeing a lot of buzz in the hallway as well, but not so much in the context of just having it, but having it as a service and having it available so you can pick and choose how much. I think that's incredibly interesting as well.
Well, you're going to hear, I mean, Matt Garman didn't want to steal the thunder from Swami. I got a preview from Swami. I did publish the video. It's out on SiliconANGLE as a story as well. But if you look at what he's going to talk about, he's going to really talk about the productivity revolution.
Yep.
I think AI is the killer app with productivity. The real world impact, the rise of agents. Matt Garman briefly talked about multiple agents, systems of agents. That's agentic systems. Again, the research we're doing. And then you're going to see, you know, democratizing data be a huge, empowering the non-technical user. You mentioned it earlier. And then converging data and AI as a game changer. These are the themes tomorrow we're going to hear from Swami and his session. So I think Matt left a lot of meat on the bone for Swami to chew at tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, we see production applications just accelerating using AI, right? Just nine months ago, we saw only 18% of production applications using AI. Compared to today, we see 54% of production applications using AI, and that's just growing. Right, so if you're not on that bandwagon of using AI to enhance your productivity, I think you're going to be left behind, and it's a competitive advantage.
Well, Paul, we're super psyched that you're heading up on the app dev piece. I know you got a big survey. You're doing a lot more research.
I do. Yep.
And you've got a Q2. We're going to do a digital twin event in Palo Alto and New York City at the New York Stock Exchange.
Yep.
I'm going to be doing a ton of editorial. I'm going to partner with you on that. So anyone's got any use cases on the editorial side, love customer stories. I'll be digging those into. You'll be doing the research.
Absolutely.
What's the focus of this first half of the year for you? And what are you going to be looking at? What are you going to be unpacking? What are you going to be digging into? And what could you use for help?
For sure.
Folks watching, they could be companies, they could be end users. We're open for business on all contents, of course. Send it our way. What are you looking for?
Yeah, so I mean, that's a great question. From a research perspective, my research calendar is really targeting day zero build, day one release. And you know, I have some day two, I have the day two data ready to go in my DevSecOps research. So that's gonna be the first kind of start of the year. That's gonna lead in what we're gonna do this App Dev Summit. Right, and this App Dev Summit is really going to help promote like this research. We're going to go through that information. We're starting to socialize those questions today. I actually walked through the halls and had a couple of conversations, and people are loving it. They're loving where we're going with the information, and I'm actually soliciting that information. That's why I could use help. Yeah. Is like, if this does this resonate or not. So I'd love to just connect with people about like, hey, this is where I'm going, and you know, and I believe in a give to get right model. If somebody helps me with it, I'm more than happy to provide a readout of the information.
Well, we got a lot of customers, a lot of CUBE alumni and fans out there, love theCUBE. We'd love your input. If you got any help on the app dev side, you have input. And by the way, we want to hear from you because, you know, we're trying to put the puzzle pieces together. Certainly, Gen AI is poised to become the defining technology for this next level. Agents are coming. The cloud native infrastructure is emerging so fast and stabilizing so fast. That is going to set the foundation for what the enablement's going to be. It's going to be disruptive, but it's going to be a disruptive enablement. And again, if you're on the wrong side of this, Paul, I see a potentially extinction moment for companies because this is not you can't get this wrong. Watch the winds, zoom out, watch the trees. Don't get into the bark of the tree. Look at the forest, look at the whole thing.
Yeah.
You got to get this right. How do people get it right?
Well, I mean, they get it right by using the tools that are available to them, right? I mean, if you're using these AI tools as a productivity enabler to help generate your code, I'm not saying replace everybody with AI. That's not it at all, right? And developers will have a job, right? They will, don't worry about that. But I mean, we still need a human in the loop, right? That's just how it's going to work. but I do believe that if you're not utilizing the tech stack and the tools, operational efficiencies, if you're not doing that, you're going to be competitively at a disadvantage. And your company, to your point, it's an extinction event, right? Your company may go out of business because your competitors are going to use it.
Yeah. Paul, I love these analyst angle sessions. I learn a lot. And, you know, it's really about getting the data and appreciate you bringing that analyst notebook content to theCUBE here. And we'll see you on theCUBE Insight segments later on. Thanks
absolutely.
For coming.
Yeah, thanks
all
for
right,
me.
CUBE coverage here. We're bringing down the whole CUBE team is here. SiliconANGLE team coverage. Rob Hope's here, Mark Albus and the entire team back at the ranch working on the stories. TheCUBE.net, we're here with theCUBE. Our entire team is here. our production team, our team running the show in Palo Alto, and of course we've got our NYSE facility down there, and of course theCUBE Research, we're up to 12 analysts now, 15, I don't know the number, it's growing really fast. The industry analysts are getting the data, the puzzle pieces to help solve the puzzle for the future, and they're doing their job, they're here as well. You see a lot more, that analyst summit is going to flow through here, we'll get that data to you, of course. More 12th year, reInvent, getting all the data, sharing that all to you here in theCUBE. Thanks for watching.